The Witcher is a story about how society turns people into monsters. Originally a series of fantasy short stories and later novels written throughout the 80s and 90s by Andrzej Sapkowski, The Witcher has been adapted into a series of best-selling video games and a Netflix show. It's basically Poland's Lord of the Rings, only instead of being a story about temptation, loss of innocence, and great heroes cleansing the land of evil, it takes place in a world of monsters and politics, where our hero's innocence was lost long ago, and the story is mostly about him rediscovering his humanity. The series follows the adventures of Geralt of Rivia, a professional monster slayer known as a Witcher. He's our point of view character, but over time the story becomes less about him and more about his adopted daughter Ciri. The Witcher, you see, originally refers to Geralt, but by the end it describes Ciri because he's all but abandoned his monster hunting ways at the end of the books and then dies. The games brought him back to life and told a brand new story that takes place about 5 years later, and before the Netflix show came out, this is the version most people were familiar with because the books didn't come out in English until the first game sold well enough that it proved there was a market for this franchise outside of Poland. There were other translations before that, but the games are where the franchise really hit the big time. While early critics were quick to compare the Netflix show to Game of Thrones, it proved to be a much different experience for the people who actually watched the whole thing. There is a lot of courtly intrigue in the actual novel series, but the early short stories adapted by the first season of the show were far more concerned with monsters and the people who hunt them. I'm not going to get into a full plot summary because this isn't that kind of essay. If you're not familiar with the story of The Witcher, then I'd suggest at least watching the show, since it's a pretty good introduction to the characters and it's only 8 episodes. Go watch it. I'll still be here when you get back. On November 9th, 2020, there was a Twitter thread posted by Sarah Thompson, a professional disability consultant who works for Artel Sorain Games, a company that not only invented the cyberpunk role-playing system, but also publishes the official Witcher tabletop RPG. She came up with the rules for the combat wheelchair, which was featured in recent episodes of the popular Dungeons & Dragons streaming show Critical Role. In the thread, she outlines how Geralt became heavily injured and disabled halfway through the novel series, which lasts all the way until the end, and laments that CD Projekt Red, who developed and published The Witcher video games, erased his disability in the interest of making gameplay simpler. The thread was seen and retweeted by the showrunner for the Netflix show, Lauren S. Hisrick, who promised that later seasons of the show will incorporate these elements. That interaction is mainly what inspired this video. The books actually deal with disability a lot, and Geralt's disability wasn't the only one erased by the games. Today we'll be looking at the way disability is handled in The Witcher, first by looking at the books, then the games, and finally the Netflix show. And along the way, we'll examine what this story tells us about people that society insists aren't worth telling stories about. First, let's go over why this matters. In a lot of fantasy stories, especially fantasy games, we often don't get to see people with disabilities represented at all, and for a long time we haven't exactly been represented well. And yes, for the record, I am disabled. I've gone into it in previous videos, but I have type 1 diabetes, ADHD, OCD, and a history of clinical depression. And if you think those aren't really disabilities, well, the Americans with Disabilities Act disagrees with you, buddy. Diabetes can absolutely fuck you up, and I have extensive nerve damage in my legs and feet that makes sitting down for long periods of time absolutely excruciating. ADHD makes it difficult to concentrate on top of feeling like all my friends secretly hate me, and OCD isn't just being a neat freak. It comes with intrusive thoughts that are fucking nightmarish and can cause actual trauma. And if you don't think depression can utterly debilitate a person, I'm not going to be the one to convince you. Basically, it's a miracle that I'm able to make this video at all. So seeing, for example, a protagonist who not only develops major chronic pain, but who closes himself off from the world to deal with the fact that most of his social interactions involve rejection of some kind, who lies to himself that he can't feel anything to spare himself the pain, and then seeing him not only get to be a hero, but an eminently human and relatable one who finds a close-knit group of people who love him in spite of all the ways he sabotages himself, can be pretty fucking impactful. It's part of why I was drawn to these stories, and the truth is I honestly didn't realize that was the case until I read through that Twitter thread. The great thing about stories is that it can be empowering to see a character experience the same struggles as you and come out the other end stronger. And The Witcher really does have something for everybody if you look hard enough. We'll be looking at the books first since in my opinion they have the most to offer in terms of representing disability. If your only exposure to the series comes through the show or the games, I highly recommend reading them because they offer a raw, unfiltered look at this world that sort of gets diluted and streamlined when adapted into other media. But if you don't have time for that, I recommend watching the Witcher Mania series by the channel Curio, which is where I got a lot of my insights into the franchise even though I'd already read the books, played the games, and watched the show. It's a really great overview of the themes of the series and how to approach it in general, but we're going to be narrowing our focus a bit today. Oh, and because this is super relevant whenever we're talking about The Witcher, you should follow this link to learn more about the situation in Poland. Right now, a fascist government is cracking down on LGBT people in Poland and trying to create LGBT-free zones. People are being harassed and threatened just for being who they are, and if the history of fascism is anything to go by, they won't stop there. Disabled people were one of the groups that the Nazis went after the hardest, and we can't let history repeat itself. We need to stop it before it gets any worse. Follow the link to find out how you can help. With that out of the way, let's talk about the books.
Magic doesn't work on me. Silver does, though.
Silver is for monsters.
The first two books in the series, The Last Wish and Sword of Destiny, were originally a series of short stories published in the magazines and later collected into these two volumes, while the rest of the books are proper novels that tell a much larger overarching story. There are a few key players to be aware of for the purpose of this essay if you haven't read them. First, we have Geralt, the titular Witcher, a professional monster slayer who was mutated using magic for that exact purpose. He starts off the series trying to remain detached and emotionless, but right from the beginning you can see that he's a person who can't help but care. Can't help but get involved even if he doesn't recognize it himself. Witchers, we're told, can't feel human emotion because they've been mutated so far beyond humanity by what they went through, but after spending like 5 minutes with Geralt, you can see this is an obvious lie, one spread by the Witchers themselves. His growth as a character comes from him slowly shedding these ideas, gradually moving away from the way he's been taught to live until, by the end, he's not really the Witcher anymore. Next we have Ciri, the child bonded to Geralt by destiny, whose story is kind of a perversion of the exiled princess trope. Her arc properly begins when her kingdom, Sintra, is invaded and ransacked by Nilfgaard, an empire to the south. Normally in stories like this, the princess will be hidden away for a few years, only to come back wiser and stronger and ever more beautiful to take her kingdom back. It's kind of intentionally absurd how important she is and how perfect she seems at first, and it's all the setup for how absolutely fucked her story gets later on. By the end, as I mentioned before, the Witcher no longer refers to Geralt because she becomes the true main character of the story. There's also Yennefer of Vengerberg, Geralt's on-again-off-again love interest and Ciri's mother figure, who's also a powerful sorceress who has grand political motivations and her own agenda. Triss Marigold is another sorceress who helped raise Ciri and used to be friends with Yennefer until Geralt came between them. She's actually in the books a lot less than her importance in the games, it suggests, but she is there at the very end, when Geralt and Yennefer lay down their lives and Ciri, who's been narrating the entire final book, runs away and chooses her own future. And while I love how complex the plot gets later on, and there are some legitimately shocking twists, there's beautiful simplicity to the early short stories. The overarching theme of the series can be found in one of these stories, spoken by Geralt himself.
People. Geralt turned his head. Like to invent monsters and monstrosities. Then they seem less monstrous themselves. When they get blind drunk, cheat, steal, beat their wives, starve an old woman, when they kill a trapped fox with an axe or riddle the last existing unicorn with arrows, they like to think that the bane entering cottages at daybreak is more monstrous than they are. They feel better then. They find it easier to live.
The show even opens with a story like this. Renfri, Geralt is told by the mage who wants him to kill her, was cursed to be evil because she was born during an eclipse, appropriately called the Curse of the Black Sun. The other girls like her had to be locked in towers and killed, you see, because a prophecy foretold that they would make the streets run red with blood. The mages identified their monstrous tendencies using some of the same methods we use to profile criminals today. These girls had strange, violent dreams and displayed a propensity for cruelty, including animal torture and maiming their servants. But we're led to question how much of that is true by a small detail. Strykobor says that the man he hired to kill Renfri was found dead, with her mother's brooch buried in his ear. But we later see that Renfri is wearing that same brooch, which Geralt carries with him throughout the rest of his adventures as a reminder of what happened when he couldn't reason with her and was forced to kill her instead. A detail that I like about the short story that got changed in the show is that Geralt already knew Strykobor before this and immediately clocks that he's hiding from Renfri not because he's concerned for the greater good of the world, but because he's terrified of owning up to his mistakes and facing the consequences. Geralt eventually figures this out in the show too, and I like that they threw in the detail about Falkle's rebellion because it shows that mages like Strykobor are more terrified of another peasant uprising than literally anything else. Renfri, for her part, only acts like a monster because society made her one. She was imprisoned, raped, and left to fend for herself from a young age, so naturally she wants to get some payback on the man who took her life away from her. The story makes it obvious that the Curse of the Black Sun isn't what made her so resentful, but how she was treated with scorn and suspicion because of it. It became a self-fulfilling prophecy because society had already decided what kind of person she was, and no matter how much Geralt tries to persuade her otherwise, she just can't let it go. There's a pattern that emerges throughout these early stories of Geralt finding someone trapped in the role society casts them in, telling them they should try to assimilate like he did, and then being shown why that just isn't possible. Phil Vandrell, King of the Elves, explains to him that the Elves can't submit to integrating into human society on humans' terms. Yennefer doesn't want to give up the pursuit of finding power for herself outside the influence of the Brotherhood's sorcerers, because giving that up would mean going back to feeling helpless and at their mercy. And Renfri would rather die than give up her revenge, because as long as Dragobor lives, she'll never be free. This is the beginning of Geralt realizing that the real monsters in society are people with power who will do anything, up to and including murder, to hold on to that power. And as the series goes on, we see that the way they hold on to that power is by turning the rest of society against those that they decide are a threat. By the end of the first episode of the show, Geralt has a blade to Stregobor's throat, but Stregobor still holds all the power because the crowd is on his side. That's actually an improvement on the original short story, which Geralt title drops as the very last line when he says killing Renfri and her entire gang was the lesser evil. Geralt tried not to get involved. He tried to get Renfri to just abandon her revenge quest and killed her when she wouldn't stop. And what does he get in return? He gets run out of town and stuck with the moniker that'll haunt him the rest of his life, the Butcher of Blaviken. He gets turned into a monster. There's large focus on disfigurement in the books, especially in the early stories as well as in the novels. Geralt's body is covered in scars, and while the games and Netflix show opted to make him absolutely gorgeous in a rugged, dangerous-looking way, in the books he's described as kind of fucking hideous. Yennefer was born with a hunchback and a crooked jaw, and becoming a sorceress involved having her physical imperfections fixed. She'll be getting her own section later on where we'll discuss how the Netflix show handles it, but the books present it more as a rite of passage that all mages have to go through because that's just what their society expects from those who join their ranks. Triss isn't immune from this either. Remember this part in the Battle of Sodden Hill where she gets stabbed with a torch? Yeah, in the books she got burned so badly that she didn't have any skin left, and they put her name on the memorial for the fallen because nobody recognized her. The mages fixed her up, but she was left with extensive burn scars all over her body to the point where she swore off low-cut dresses forever. Not that CD Projekt Red seems to have gotten that memo. Much later in the series, Ciri gets a facial scar under her left eye after escaping from captivity, and a fun bit of trivia is that she got it from the throwing star because the people coming after her from Nilfgaard are all basically anime villains. I'm barely kidding about that. Vilgefortz drops lines straight out of Dragon Ball Z, Bonhart is a nigh unbeatable swordsman who's good enough to kill witchers and uses Ciri's desire to beat him and escape as a means of training her to fight in an arena run by his cousin, and as we've already covered, Stefan Skellin uses fucking ninja stars. In the books, her scar is described as absolutely horrific and people are super put off by it, and there's even a line in Wild Hunt about how Ciri's using a special face cream given to her by Albalok as a way of explaining how much they prettied it up when Skellin does much more disfiguring in the books. Speaking of Vilgefortz, he gets hit with a face full of rubble after handing Geralt's ass to him and chasing Ciri towards a malfunctioning portal that she disappears through and ends up losing an eye. He tries to grow it back using magic, but by the time our heroes fight him again, his face is still horribly scarred and the replacement eye hasn't grown all the way in yet.
Who the fuck are you?
I'm Vilgefortz of Roggevein.
Why are you whispering?
I should probably take a second here and explain who Vilgefortz actually is, because he's only in like two episodes of the Netflix show, and because the Battle of Sodden Hill isn't even depicted in the books, only referenced after the fact, we aren't properly introduced to him until much later. Long story short, this guy is responsible for everything that goes wrong, all the way from the Fall Center to the final battle of the Second Northern War. Halfway through the series, he stages an attempted coup at Aretuza, a school for mages where Yennefer was trained, and where they hoped to train Ciri. After he gets blasted in the face by rocks, he spends the rest of the story in hiding before capturing Yennefer and Ciri. His plan is to get Ciri pregnant so that he can use her magic blood, called the Elder Blood, for a ritual to give himself godlike power. Everyone else in the story also wants her pregnant for their own reasons, but this guy really goes the extra mile. Like I said, anime villain. Now, normally in stories, especially out of fantasy, physical disfigurement is used to represent some deeper moral flaw and has been a shortcut for villain coding for basically as long as stories have existed. The Witcher avoids all this by giving the heroes of its narrative just as many scars as the villains, if not more so, and by showing how the stereotype causes people in society to treat them like monsters. Geralt is barely tolerated wherever he goes because he's a mutant, Yennefer was sold to the mages because her family didn't want her, Renfri and the other girls afflicted by the curse of the Black Sun had internal mutations, and Ciri gets treated like absolute shit by everyone she meets for like the last three books. Before she got that scar, her beauty came up in practically every conversation, and now she has a 2,000-year-old King of the Elves telling her that looking at her is like finding a pearl in a pile of shit. Although honestly, that has just as much to do with the fact that the animal race is as fuck. The books cover mental disabilities as well, though not nearly to the same extent. When Geralt cures the Striga, he mentions that she'll have the mental capabilities of someone who lived their entire life knowing nothing but hunger and rage, and that she'll need special care. I actually want to highlight how different that story is in the books, because the show portrays King Foltest a lot differently. In the books, he doesn't make any secret of the fact that he had an incestuous relationship with his sister, and Lord Ostrich's plan wasn't motivated by him loving Princess Atta as much as it was using the Striga to make Foltest look weaker in the eyes of his rival kingdoms. In the show, it's Geralt who comes up with the idea of curing the Striga, but in the original story, a cunning woman had come through a few years early and told King Foltis that she could be cured, and he's only willing to offer a reward for someone to try lifting the curse. Anyway, Foltis basically just sits down with Geralt and says that he doesn't expect him not to defend himself, but that he should try to cure her as a first resort. We should talk about curses, actually, because they're pretty closely associated with this ability in settings like this. The Netflix show added the detail about Yennefer thinking she was cursed with a crooked spine because her father was half-elf, but that's not really in the books, and in the original version, her mother was the one who wanted her gone. There are also monsters that can be created through a curse, like the Striga, but what I love about the story in particular is how Geralt points out that a spell had to be cast for it to take effect after Foltis asked if she became a monster just because she was a product of incest. It's kind of weird that one of the main arguments against incest is that it can lead to birth defects and not, you know, that incest is just completely disgusting on its own. We should be able to say it's just wrong without having to convince people by arguing that children had no say in how they were conceived and might come out deformed. The Netflix show also cut the ending of that story a little short, because the entire framing device for the first collection of short stories is Geralt recovering at the Temple of Melitele after he almost dies from when the Striga wounds him before she's fully transformed back. While he's at the temple, he explains his whole backstory to a woman named Iola, who performs these kind of silent therapy sessions because she's non-verbal. Iola later leaves the temple and helps take care of the wounded during the final battle in the last book, and I liked how this minor character that any other story would have just forgotten about got to make a difference in the end. There's another character who crushed on Ciri while she was studying in the temple who loses a hand in that battle and names his granddaughter after her. It's these little details that end up painting a larger picture where people with disabilities are included as just part of the world, rather than being some exception to the norm. Much later in the books, when Geralt is traveling through an active war zone on his way to rescue Ciri, he and his group of allies come across a woman who's about to be burned as a witch. She's very clearly suffering some sort of psychotic episode and is out of touch with the reality, but the villagers antagonizing her don't have the proper language or understanding to recognize that. Regis ends up calming her down with his vampire powers, and they save her from the crowd that was ready to destroy her even though she wasn't really posing a threat to anybody. And while he's on this journey, Geralt is dealing with chronic pain brought on by getting a bunch of his bones broken by Vilgefortz. Now, it's true that the waters of Brocklawn healed him, but the story makes a point of how he's not fully healed before he leaves on his journey, and Regis later brings up how his whole nervous system is completely fucked up now. It's not like he's rendered completely useless by this. He learns to work with his disability, and he's still far more capable with the sword than your average man. But he'll never get back to where he was, and accepting that is part of learning to live with the disability. It's honestly really powerful to see a character experience the same problems as me, especially one who's had this much of a cultural impact. It's too bad the games didn't really bring that across. Now, I should start this out by saying that I think CD Projekt Red, the development studio behind the games, means well. At least the people actually making the games, not the horrible billionaire ghouls at the top. They're very clearly diehard fans of the original books, and as I mentioned earlier, those books found an international audience based on the success of these games. They care enough to include all sorts of representation in their games. They put a gay character and a trans character in The Witcher 3 basically just because they wanted to, not for any sort of marketing reason. Wild Hunt tells a very compelling story centering around themes of fatherhood and toxic masculinity. The game isn't about defeating the ultimate evil or being the ultimate badass wish fulfillment fantasy, but about reconnecting with your daughter so you can make sure she has a better future. There's a lot of effort and artistry that goes into the writing for these games, and they're made by people who clearly care. But having good intentions isn't enough when it comes to writing about experiences outside your own, and the recently released Cyberpunk 2077 is an object lesson in how they could have avoided landing in a controversy every 10 minutes if they consulted with actual trans people before locking your character's pronouns to which voice you choose, or trying to claim that any of your ads are an example of fictional corporations co-opting of trans bodies, and CD Projekt are themselves a giant corporation doing exactly that, and treating their workers like total dog shit. And on the disability side of things, not only were the accessibility options bare bones in the same year that The Last of Us Part 2 raised the bar just by actually hiring disability consultants, but a critical story quest involves an effect that's based on something doctors use to induce a seizure when they're diagnosing epilepsy. It took an uproar on Twitter just to get them to add an epilepsy warning to the beginning of the game. Now, credit where it's due. The dev team did acknowledge that they fucked this up, and even worked directly with Theona Rupert, an editor at Game Informer who has epilepsy, to make the game safer to play. But in a game this high profile with a development cycle this long, it should never have gotten to that point, and if they'd thought to hire a disability consultant, it probably wouldn't have. Also, a few internet ghouls who disagree with Theona's review of the game keep sending her videos of that blog to hers, which is literally assault, so once again the internet has a horrible nightmare place where joy goes to die. Also, you can't remap controls if you're playing on console, the subtitles are insultingly small, ton dialogue choices are timed and don't give you very much time to read them, but hey, at least they're adjusting the number of dildos in the game. Now that's punk! What I'm saying is that at a certain point it becomes straight up negligent to not do your research when you're operating at the level that CD Projekt Red does, and for all the goodwill that their Witcher games brought them, they've kind of just been pissing it away lately. And it sucks because these are clearly fuck-ups in management that end up tarnishing the work of a lot of really talented people that clearly want to make amazing games. But let's talk about how they actually represent disability in the games. The first thing, as Sarah's Twitter thread points out, is that while the games do contain a couple throwaway lines indicating that Geralt consents to change in weather because his joints are in pain, his disability has absolutely no effect on the story or gameplay, and that's a real shame since a lot of people only look through the games for references that I were reading the books, and therefore miss a lot of the subtler details about these characters. It's even less excusable when it comes to Triss, because again, in the books she literally has a line saying that she'll never wear a low-cut dress again because she's ashamed of her scars. Now, there are a lot of interesting directions one could go with that, and it would be cool to see Triss come to terms with her scars more than proudly after realizing that social stigmas around appearance are total bullshit. But what CDPR opted to do instead was just ignore the fact that her scars ever existed and give her a bunch of low-cut outfits to show off her cleavage. Oh, and remember little Princess Ada? The one Geralt cured of being a Striga who had to have special care? Well, she's all grown up now in the first Witcher game, and you can have sex with her! Now, to be fair, the books do take place over the course of decades, particularly the short stories, and by the time the game takes place, it's reasonable that Ada would have had time to get an education and be reintroduced into society. But to put her in the same category as all the women in that game that you can trigger sex with, sometimes without even meaning to if you pick certain dialogue options, just raises the efforts of an inexperienced dev team who was making the first game and didn't have the best handle on how to write women, especially disabled women. Oh, and a turning point in the plot involves her transforming back into a Striga, so there's that. They got a lot better with this by the time Wild Hunt released, and they populated the world with a bunch of minor characters with disabilities, like the Peller who helps you figure out what happened to the Bloody Baron's missing family. He's portrayed as a bit off, and it's later revealed that the trauma he suffered from killing his abusive father gave him some pretty severe PTSD. There's also Philippa Eilhard, who had her eyes gouged at the end of Witcher 2 and is trying to replace them using the same method Vilgefortz did. Her blindness only really comes into play in the side quest where you rescue her from Dijkstra, and after that her sight is magically simulated, which all things considered is honestly a pretty good way of handling it since it doesn't really go away, but rather makes use of their world's equivalent of sight restoration that scientists in our world are working to make possible using technology. Speaking of PTSD and eyes being gouged out, Geralt's trip to Skellige brings him into contact with Jarl Udalric, who's been extremely reclusive and paranoid ever since his brother died at sea. Some people think Udalric murdered him, but it turns out it was just an accident with horrible timing, because they'd had a fight recently and his brother died while Udalric was trying to make it up to him. Then he got possessed by a demon. The Heim is an interesting twist on demonic possession, because it ends up being one of the most perfect metaphors for depression I've seen in a game like this. Depression really can feel like a monster on your back, whispering in your ear that nothing you ever do is good enough to make up for the sin of existing. The Heim is a parasite that quite literally feeds on pain and negative emotions, and does everything it can to keep Udalric in that mental state while everyone else thinks he's either insane or chosen by the gods. Something I find especially interesting is that after tricking the Heim into briefly possessing Geralt by making Geralt think he did a truly horrible thing by throwing a baby in an oven, the baby's fine, don't worry about it, Geralt tells Udalric that the feeling of emptiness he's experiencing is normal and will pass as he recovers.
You're disoriented, but don't worry, it'll pass.
I feel as if someone's torn something from me.
That's normal. The Heim was a parasite. Bonds between parasites and hosts can be strong. That's why you feel empty now. Give it a few days, weeks, you'll be fine.
Sometimes we can live with mental illness for so long that it's hard to imagine living without it, and depression can leave scars in your soul that feel like they'll never go away, no matter how far you get along the path to recovering and learning to live with it. There's also a questline after Dandelion gets rescued in which Priscilla, the woman he's truly fallen in love with after fooling around for decades, is abducted and tortured by a serial killer who gets scared off before he can finish. Turns out the attacker was really a higher vampire who wanted to steer people towards the Church of the Eternal Fire, an oppressive xenophobic religion that's currently burning the people they blame for all of society's problems. This week it's mages, and if you rescue them, then they'll move on to dwarves, elves, halflings, and other non-humans. Part of this killer's process involves forcing his victims to drink formaldehyde, which burns through Priscilla's esophagus to the point where she loses her voice, which as someone who makes her living by singing is an especially huge blow. But in a true test of his newfound sense of commitment, Dandelion stays by her side, and in one ending of the game he mentions that she got her singing voice back and she can even hit the low notes now. I'm not sure how to feel about that. For one thing, the whole questline centers Dandelion and the way the serial killer's actions affect him, and Priscilla's just kind of dropped from the story after it's over with no follow-up quests. This happens with a lot of the side characters after their quests are over, but the beginning of the game's third act uses Dandelion's new cabaret as a central hub, and she's nowhere to be seen. I don't know, it would have been nice to check in with her and see how she's recovering, especially since she's been such a vibrant and entertaining character leading up to that point. The main problem is that what happens to her isn't really about her. The questline immediately before this is about Dandelion proving that he's willing to commit to her by renovating the brothel he inherited from a man who literally went by the name Whoreson Sr. and turning it into a classier establishment. Now that's its own can of worms, and one of the NPCs who helps you track down the killer is a sex worker who got offered a part in one of Brazil's plays, but my point is that the attack is meant to be a surprise twist that ruins Dandelion's whole plan. This is one of the problems that the games run into in depicting women, by the way. If their name isn't Yennefer or Triss, then they basically don't exist as soon as the story is done with them. Brazil is used as a plot device to show how much Dandelion has grown, but we don't get to directly see how she grows and recovers from this traumatic experience. It's just, congratulations, you slayed the monster, quest completed, take your experience points and move on to the next thing. Like I said, there's a throwaway line in one of the endings that tells us what happens to her, but she isn't even there to deliver that news herself. The whole thing just represents a lot of missed potential. And then there's Uma. Uma, named for both the only word he seems capable of saying and standing for ugliest man alive, is really the cursed form of Avalok, a curse Ciri was trying to lift when they were separated. Again, curses as both a mechanism and metaphor for disability is kind of interesting here, since Aridin's goal was to humiliate Avalok, not kill him.
Turned out Aridin had other plans. He produced the phylactery, uncorked it. A fog enveloped us. And Avalok began gasping for air.
That's how Aridin cursed Avalok. Triggered his transformation into Uma?
Yes. He didn't wish to kill him. Humiliation, that's what he was after.
It is kind of fucked that being disabled in that way is so often framed as a fate worse than death, and even though this works in the context of the story being told, the writers have to walk a pretty delicate balancing act, and this is where they show how much their storytelling skill has evolved since the first game. A major story quest involves lifting the curse using the Trial of the Grasses, a horrifying procedure the Witchers go through in order to acquire their mutations, and that only 3 out of every 10 boys survive. What I really like about this part is how Geralt and the other Witchers don't treat Uma with disgust or revulsion. They talk to him like a normal person, even if he's not really capable of communicating back. They want to help him, and they understand what it's like to be treated like an oddity wherever they go. Lambert in particular reacts with anger when Yennefer suggests using the Trial of the Grasses because he doesn't want anybody to go through what they did, even if it is in the interest of removing a curse that they never asked for. Overall, the games do fuck up in places when it comes to depicting disability, but stuff like this shows that they were trying and they did learn from some of their mistakes. There's a lot of heart that went into them, and I'd still recommend them to anyone who asks. So as we previously covered, the Netflix show takes a few liberties with the books, often in ways to make the story flow better for television without losing too much of the original message. I actually like the structure of the multiple timelines, and as someone who read the books first, it was fun spotting all the little things that they changed or left out, and even improved upon in quite a few areas. Triss wasn't originally part of the story where Geralt cures the Striga, for example, since that was the first Witcher story ever published, but it's a damn sight better than having Yennefer offhandedly mention her name during the bathtub scene in The Last Wish and then introducing her properly with 3 pages of info dumping in Blood of Elves. It was also really nice to see the Battle of Sodden Hill get used as the action climax of Season 1, whereas in the books the battle has already been over for weeks by the time Geralt comes across the memorial and finds Triss's name on it. But if we're really talking about changes the show made that expanded on its characters, we need to talk about Yennefer. Yennefer is a character who is very near and dear to my heart. She's not just my favorite character in this entire franchise, she's one of my top 5 favorite characters in anything, ever. I love her anger, her bold ambition, her sharp tongue, and her enormous capacity for love when she feels safe enough to let her defenses drop. She was already ruthless in the books, but in the show she's practically bloodthirsty. She stabs the leader of the Reavers in the fucking neck and doesn't even blink, which is a lot better than how that story played out in the books, where she got tied up and had her shirt ripped open while Dandelion stared at her tits. Overall, she is portrayed as cunning, badass, and has so much depth as a character that you could drown in her. My friend Erica described her best.
I don't know anything about The Witcher, but Yennefer can spit in my mouth.
The thing about Yennefer is that in any other fantasy story, she'd be the villain, the evil sorceress who lusted after power. But both the books and the show make it clear that her desire for power is really a displaced desire to live her life safe from those who might wish her harm, or who just want to use her. A story that didn't make it into the first season of the show is called A Shard of Ice, which includes an in-universe legend about a witch who enthralls men by piercing their hearts with, you guessed it, a shard of ice, but wants to live in warmer climates. She ends up torn between keeping the man she loves under her spell, or possibly losing him if she lets that spell break. In the end, Yennefer can't decide between Geralt and Istrid and leaves them both because she doesn't think either of them could really love her if they saw her the way she sees herself. As I mentioned earlier, Yennefer's disability is only ever hinted at in the books, with details like Geralt noticing that one of her shoulders is lower than the other and a brief explanation of how mages have their physical imperfections removed before being allowed to study magic. The show goes a lot deeper into it, and the part that a lot of critics and fans took issue with was the transformation scene in Episode 3. So there's a lot we need to unpack here. There are a couple of gross lines, like this one.
Let me be candid, you are a first draft of what nature intended is. Lucky for you, I am the final artist.
Then Desea comes in and tells Yennefer to
imagine the most powerful woman in the world.
And then covers up part of her reflection in the mirror. This scene makes it clear that Yennefer isn't the one who has a problem with her appearance. I mean, she does, but it mostly has to do with how people have treated her because of it. The people pushing her toward changing her appearance are the ones who invested time and effort into her to make her the vessel for their own expectations, and they can't just send her out in the world looking the way she does. Intercutting the transformation with the Strigify was something that puzzled me for a while until I realized that neither Yennefer nor the Striga asked for any of this. As much as she hated her life sleeping in the pig pens, Yennefer didn't want to leave it. She was sold to the Brotherhood of Sorcerers and tried to kill herself on her first night there because she wanted to control over something. But as Desea points out, she wasn't taking control. She was losing it. The part I think is crucial is that, in the scenes before her ascension, we're shown that Yennefer is every bit as sharp, confident, and ambitious as she is later in the show. It's only the outer form that's different. She tells Istra that she doesn't want to be beautiful. She wants to be powerful. She doesn't want to be that scared little girl who knows so little about the world that she had no idea how much power she had to affect it. The ascension represents a way out for her, a way to live the life she feels she's owed after suffering for so long. And if she has to suffer a little more pain to get that, then so be it. The transformation scene is brutal in a way that no other scene in the show is, and we can feel the pain of what Yennefer is going through. Comparing her suffering to that of the Striga fits here because we're meant to sympathize with both of them. And if this had been the end of Yennefer's arc, a symbolic rebirth to mark the beginning of a new life for her, then yeah, I'd agree it's probably a little fucked up to portray having her body fixed as a reward. But it's a lot more complicated than that. The very next episode shows Yennefer 30 years later, looking exactly the same, and she's still no closer to feeling like she's worth something to anybody. Desea told Yennefer that her greatest fear was that even if she were a beauty, no one would love her, and that's come true because Yennefer isn't living life on her own terms. She's come to realize that her sacrifice wasn't worth it, that she's only playing into the expectations others had for her in spite of all that talk about how her ideal self was supposed to represent her own desires. So when an assassin comes along and murders a woman who can't even appreciate that she's trying to save the life of her and her baby, she realizes how hollow it all is and decides to try something new. This is where Geralt first meets her, and the reason I like their love story so much is that both of them behave like assholes as a way of protecting themselves, but they let that facade drop as soon as they feel safe. There's a scene later in the books where they're reunited after Yennefer's been training Ciri, and she just keeps saying, "Love me," as they spend the night together. But both of them are insecure and missing an important purpose in their lives, so they tend to drift apart and fly back together again, spending most of the series as on-again, off-again bitter exes because they're both couple drama queens with a lot of self-image issues and even more baggage when it comes to trusting others. Yennefer's arc in Season 1 culminates in her return to Aretuza, where she confronts the system that she thought would give her power, but took her freedom as its price. She tries to warn the next generation of girls to keep what happened to her from happening to them, but her words don't have a chance to take hold before she's interrupted by Desea. During the meeting with the Brotherhood of Sorcerers, Yennefer lets her feelings be known and insists that she doesn't care if Nilfgaard burns down the entire north. But then she agrees to help Desea and the others stop them. I didn't understand that for a long time, and to be fair, Yennefer doesn't have an answer for it either.
Why did you come?
But I think it goes back to that first night in Aretuza when she slit her wrist just to feel like she had control over something. It's worth remembering that what prompts her return to this place is her leaving Geralt again after learning about the wish he made to keep them bonded by destiny. Yennefer has just learned that she has no control over the way her life plays out because of a wish that was intended to save that same life. I don't think she joined the fight because she wanted to save the North. I think she was looking for a way to die on her own terms. But it's Desea of all people who snaps her out of it. The night before the battle, Yennefer says she's ready to die because she's lived two or three lifetimes already. But Desea points out that she hasn't been satisfied in any of them. Later, when the battle is almost over, when Nilfgaard has nearly overrun them, Desea tells Yennefer to forget everything she was taught about controlling her emotions, controlling the ocean of chaos roiling inside her. Forget the rules. Forget the establishment that taught her. Forget the limits she's placed on herself. Let it all burn. Yennefer does eventually find a purpose, just like Geralt does, when she meets Ciri and finds the piece of her that was missing all those years. Being transformed into a physically perfect form wasn't what brought her happiness, and the power she was after to make herself feel safe didn't do the trick either. It was love that saved her. It was love that made her final sacrifice worth it. Now all that said, the problem we run into with this analysis is that it's all based purely on what's being told to us by the text. Dan Olsen coined the term Thermian argument to describe the sort of explanation that only takes the events of the story into account without considering the larger real-life context surrounding them. If Yennefer were an actual person with real thoughts and desires, we could look at her story and say, yeah, that's empowering as hell. But the fact remains that Anya Schlatter is an able-bodied actress in a hell of a lot of makeup and prosthetics who's playing pretend. We are, consciously or not, just waiting for her to shed that costume so that we can see what she really looks like. Also, in the show, Yennefer is the only visibly disabled person in the whole of Artusa. Now, I understand that they need to streamline a lot, but the books do briefly mention that physically disabled girls are given to Artusa because they'd be useless anywhere else. In the show, Yennefer's fellow students are all able-bodied, and if they do have any disabilities that aren't immediately obvious from looking at them, it's never brought up. By using Yennefer as basically their only physically disabled representation, it's kind of unintentionally sending the message that they were only interested in bringing it up to make a point, rather than just having disabled people exist as a normal part of the world. Another problem people had when the show first came out was that after she got transformed, it made Yennefer feel like she, quote, wasn't disabled anymore, unquote. But as I covered above, her experiences with disability continue to inform her perspective and decisions all throughout the story. A friend of mine who helped me with researching this video mentioned that Yennefer's disability being rendered invisible by this transformation helped her to connect to the character better because she lives with an invisible disability. Geralt's chronic pain fits into this as well, and honestly, as someone who struggles with a bunch of invisible disabilities myself, it really made me feel seen. Overall, I do think they did a really good job with the material, and the story does internally justify itself, but there are parts of this narrative that would have benefited from a disability consultant, and I'm glad that a Twitter thread posted by one is going to have an influence on the show going forward, although honestly, they really should just hire one. But all this does raise another interesting question. In a world where magic exists, why is disability still a thing? We could answer using the rules that this world is presented and say that it's a question of access. This sort of magic isn't for everybody, and the books actually say that the elixirs used in the process will just, like, instantly kill anybody who isn't attuned to magic the way sorcerers are. But those rules are made up because the story is made up. There are plenty of fantasy stories where disabled people aren't mentioned at all. Just introducing something like the combat wheelchair into D&D led to its creator getting harassed because people didn't think that it belonged in a world where anything can be fixed with magic. Why, in that sort of world, would you show anybody with a disability? Why would doing that make that world better? Wouldn't a perfect world be one where disability didn't exist at all? Well, there is a simple answer for that, and in fact there's a whole school of thought based on that line of questioning. Something I don't see enough people talk about is how much The Witcher focuses on reproductive rights. Andrzej Sapkowski cannot, and will not, stop using his platform to talk about how good and necessary abortion is, and how anyone who tells you otherwise is just trying to enforce a hierarchy and control people. But there's another side to it, and this is the part where we have to talk about forced sterilization. The books make it clear practically from page 1 that witchers are sterilized as part of their mutations, and sorceresses are similarly stripped of their ability to have children because the people in charge want them to perform the function they were designed for, which doesn't include children. Geralt even insists that it's one of the kinder reasons they can't have children because their lives aren't suited for them, because he's still lying to himself about not needing anybody else in his life. This line echoes an interaction Yennefer has earlier in the season in the carriage ride with the doomed young queen who ends up having an assassin sent after her because she's unable to provide the king with a male heir. She claims that Yennefer is better off not being able to have children because she doesn't have the same expectations placed on her by society of being a baby factory. She gets to have exciting adventures, participate in politics, and do all the things this woman wishes she could do. But watching Yennefer throughout this scene, it's clear from the face she makes that she doesn't feel the same way about it. When prompted to say so by the Queen, Yennefer explains that even though she's able to fill a different role in society, it's still one that was carved out for her rather than one she got to decide herself. She is, as she puts it,
glorified royal ass viper.
Later on, she confides in the baby, who died at some point in all the confusion, that to the rest of society, women are just vessels even if they get told they're special. Even if they're free from being expected to just pump out children, they're not any more free to decide their own path in life. So she says fuck that and tries to forge her own destiny anyway, and she does that by trying to undo the sacrifice that she was very obviously pressured into making. I actually love the increased emphasis the Netflix show places on this and makes it a core part of Yennefer's character and motivations. The Dragon Hunt episode, my personal favorite in the first season, plays out a lot differently than it does in the books, and this one change to Yennefer's motivation makes the story a million times more impactful. You see, in the original short story, she's after the dragon to offer its skin as a sacrifice to undo Geralt's wish, since she actually heard him make it in that version, and this story is actually where they get back together before breaking up again in a shard of ice. Here, she's after the dragon as part of yet another scheme to be able to have children after giving it up to get what she thought she wanted. The previous episode teased out the mystery of why she suddenly wants to have a baby, but here Yennefer sums it up in a single line.
Yen. A child? What could you possibly want with a child?
They took my choice. I want it back.
Something that gets overshadowed a lot in the debate about the right to choose is that, while abortion is absolutely a human right and you should always be able to make that choice, You should also have the freedom to choose the opposite, and that gets taken away from a lot of people in real life, not just fantasy stories like The Witcher. The eugenics movement of the early 20th century directly inspired a lot of what the Nazis did in concentration camps, and it wasn't just the Jews they targeted. They targeted other racial minorities, people with disabilities, homosexuals, and anyone who didn't fit into their narrow definition of what it meant to be human. The ones they didn't send to the gas chambers right away were experimented on, forced to work themselves to death, and yes, sterilized. I'm not going to go much deeper into it because holy fucking Christ, the Nazis did some monstrous shit. And it's not like America was much better. An oft-neglected fact of history is that a lot of what the Nazis did, they learned from watching us. America has a long history of involuntarily sterilizing Black, Hispanic, and Native American populations, with the forced hysterectomies happening in the ICE concentration camps only being the most recent example. In 1927, the Supreme Court ruled that a Virginia law authorizing the sterilization of mentally ill patients was constitutional, and that decision was never formally overturned. California's Asexualization Acts in the 1910s and 1920s led to over 20,000 people, mostly Black and Mexican people, being forcibly sterilized on the grounds of being mentally ill, and again, this inspired the fucking Nazis. Overall, around 70,000 people were forcibly sterilized throughout the 20th century, most of them working class women of color, all under the pretense that breeding out the undesirables would lead to a better society. There's this insidious implication underlying the whole rotten core of eugenics that only people who fit a specific ideal are worthy of existing. You shouldn't want to be anything else, and you should fear and abhor people who don't fit into that mold, be they people of color, people who exist outside rigid heterosexuality and the binary gender identity, or people with disabilities. Those people's stories don't fit into the cultural mythology, and thus shouldn't be heard or even told. It's no wonder that eugenics often goes hand in hand with fascism, because both of those ideologies operate on creating an ever-shrinking circle of what it means to be an ideal human, and both assert that everyone outside of that circle should just fucking die or be bred out of existence. And to justify this outlook, to justify the atrocities committed under this barely concealed hatred for anyone and everyone who doesn't fit into their world, they systematically rob these undesirable people of their humanity. They go on television talking about how immigrants from Mexico are coming to rape your women and do violence in your streets, all to justify throwing them in camps where women receive forced hysterectomies into their existing children and disappeared into the foster system with no record of where they ended up. They talk about how a secret cabal of Jews runs the world to justify throwing them into camps and gassing them to death. They tell stories about how mental institutions are set up to protect society from women who often just didn't want to go along with the rules of that society. They talk about how Black Lives Matter protesters are thugs who shouldn't stand up to a police force that's able to murder them without warning and without consequence. They make it sound like the only logical solution to the threat these people pose to society is to get rid of them. They turn people into monsters. The Witcher actually forms a pretty compelling argument against eugenics as one of its major themes. Witchers were created to be genetically superior in order to fight monsters and colonize the world, but they're all broken people, doing a thankless job for people who hate them right up until the moment they get more afraid of the monsters at their door than the monster slayers. The mutations didn't strip away their emotions. That's a lie they tell themselves and the rest of the world so they don't have to face the trauma of everything that got taken away from them by the process that was supposed to make them the saviors of a humanity that now hates them. And it's not like sorceresses have it much better. During her first lesson at Aretusa, Tisea tells Yennefer,
"Sometimes a flower is just a flower. And the best thing it can do for us is to die."
Later, she transforms the other students who aren't worthy of ascending, turning them into literal fuel for an institution whose sole aim and reason for existence is to enforce control over something so wild and uncontrollable they literally call it chaos. This idea that people have to be useful in order to deserve existence is at the heart of eugenics, and that's what makes it so insidious. And if you're not one of the people who matters, the only thing you're good for is serving their interests. Yennefer figured this out after 30 years of living the life someone else planned for her, and her return to Aretusa brings that into sharp focus.
The ability to create life? Real life? They take that from you. And then send you out. So the only family, the only loyalty you have is to them. And you'll trade it all for what? Looks that never change? A court full of idiots? But you don't have to do it.
Like I said, this isn't just a hypothetical problem that only exists in a fantasy world. Having to be medically sterilized to be allowed to have access to the resources needed to just survive in society is something faced not only by indigenous people and people of color, but also trans people. I mean, at least in this story, Yennefer got told what she was giving up, even if she didn't understand the full scope of what that would mean until it was too late to take it back. There are countless stories of people in the real world being lied to by doctors and other medical personnel, often involving a language barrier, who end up sterilized without giving informed consent. One of the major legacies of eugenics is the medical model of disability, which presumes that the disadvantages faced by disabled people aren't systemic, but rather a you problem. It's not all that surprising that eugenics sprung out of a society that worships capitalism and pulling yourself up by your bootstraps, because in that world, we can pretend that we don't owe things to one another. Under that mindset, Yennefer's decision makes total sense. In Aretuza, she's taught that to get what she wants, she has to sacrifice, to prove herself exceptional, to rise to the top and give up on her own ideas of the future so that she can serve the interests of the people in power. By contrast, the social model recognizes that the barriers faced by disabled people in society can be removed by that same society rather than putting all the onus on the person being hurt and disenfranchised by them. All of Yennefer's attempted solutions to undoing her sacrifice are something she's trying to pull off by herself, and that fails because the game she's playing is rigged in favor of the people who did this to her. Things only improve for her when she begins to let other people in, to reject the way she was so violently forced to see the world and allow herself to be loved. The Elder Blood is essentially one giant eugenics project, an attempt to breed the perfect being into existence, one who would master all of time and space. The story of Lara Doran is interesting because of how she fucks it all up for the NL by marrying and having children with a human, and how when Falca mixed her own child in, her madness was said to be a hereditary curse that caused people who inherited the Elder Blood to go insane and destroy themselves because they couldn't control their own power. By the time we get to Ciri, pretty much every faction other than Geralt and Yennefer want to force her to have a baby in order to fulfill a prophecy which says her children will go on to create the perfect world through their genetic superiority. But Ciri just doesn't want to, and all we can do is respect that choice, just like we have to respect Yennefer's desire to be a mother instead of insisting that she's better off not being able to have children. To be clear, I'm not saying that every attempt at making life easier for people with disabilities is full-on eugenics. There's nothing wrong with trying to restore people's sight, hearing, use of their limbs, or their body's ability to process sugar properly. Those are all worthwhile things to do in the real world, and showing how people adapt to their disabilities in fiction is good too, because too often the portrayal of disability kind of falls into misery porn, where it's assumed that we won't know a person who's disabled unless they have glass bones and paper skin and cry every night until their heart attack put them to sleep. It's not ableist to show someone functioning well with the assistance given to them, because that's kind of the goal. But it is really sketchy to suggest that the goal beyond that is to make a world where that sort of assistance isn't needed, because the people who would need it straight up don't exist. Because as harmless as that can seem in fiction, there are people advocating for that in the real world, and eugenics is something that comes up a lot in that conversation. Selective breeding is the point where things get really fucking dicey, and taking away people's ability to have children who may inherit the same disabilities is well over the fucking line. It's not done in the interest of actually helping people with disabilities. It's about bringing them under control. This can swing the other way too. Far-right extremists in Poland, the ones I mentioned at the beginning of this video, are using accusations of eugenics and hating people with disabilities to justify the passing of a law banning abortion. But even though the message is the opposite, the motive is the same. It's all about bringing people under control. They don't actually care about people with disabilities. We're just a convenient political talking point for them until it's our turn on the chopping block, because fascism can't function without an enemy to go after. If we don't seriously engage with these topics and make our stance on them clear, the other side can and will twist them to suit their own agenda. Now look, if there was a magic way to get rid of my diabetes and my chronic pain and everything else that makes it difficult for me to do certain tasks or even exist day to day, I would take it. But that should be my choice. That's not the solution eugenics is offering. It's offering a world that doesn't have room for people like me.
You're important to me.
There's a part I like in the books where, as part of Ciri's training montage, Geralt uses a pendulum to teach her how to fight the sorts of monsters the Witcher might face. Ciri says she's not strong enough, and Geralt explains that no human, not even a Witcher, is strong enough to just block the kind of blows that monsters can throw at them. But by rolling with those hits, by taking the momentum from them to enhance the power of their own strikes, a Witcher can use the creature's own strength against it. In other words, you might not think you're up to the task of doing something that will be insurmountable if you approach it head on. But if you learn to work with what you have, if you can find the right leverage, you can make the situation work to your advantage. And while this probably isn't the message Sapkowski intended with this passage, it's actually a setup for how Ciri kills Leo Bonhart in the last book, it's externally applicable to living with a disability and finding alternative ways of existing day to day when the methods that able-bodied people use aren't available to you. The simple truth of the matter is that disabled people deserve to exist in stories like this because it serves as a reminder that we exist in real life. It shows that we deserve to be treated as human just like everybody else, and one of the best ways to help people connect to a character is by showing them go through a human, relatable struggle and still come out the other side of it. I can relate to Geralt cutting himself off from the world because most of his interactions with people involve getting rejected, so he pretends that he can't feel anything and that close relationships with people don't matter anyway. I can relate to his chronic pain and his slow acceptance of the fact that he'll never get back to where he was, but that's okay because he learns how to work with what he has. And that connection, that invitation to project my own struggles onto this character make me so much more invested in the story than if he were just a generic invincible badass. The Witcher is about power structures and how the people in power enforce and maintain them. It's about how we have less to fear from vampires, leshens, wraiths, and werewolves than we do from people who cause entire populations to suffer, either through neglect or as a deliberate means of keeping them in line. It's about how society treats people who don't exist within the norms of that society, how it treats them as dangerous and untrustworthy in order to keep them from meaningfully challenging the status quo. It's about how, in a world that tries to rob you of your humanity, to convince you that some people just don't deserve to live, the most radical thing you can do is reach out and make connections with other people, to get involved and try to make the world a better place. It's tempting to act like none of this matters, to tell ourselves that it's just a book, just a game, just a TV show. But the reason we tell ourselves stories in the first place is to communicate how we feel about the world around us, and so what ends up going into a story tells us something about the person telling it and how they see the world. And if their fantasy doesn't include certain people, we should ask ourselves, who's that story really for? Instead of creating a fantasy where disabled people are either magically cured, don't exist, or are otherwise tucked away to the side where we don't have to think about them, maybe we'd be better off constructing a society where they aren't treated like monsters. Thank you for watching, everybody. I have a few people I want to thank who helped me out with making this project, so don't shut off the video just yet. I'd like to thank Andrew, who provided the voice of Geralt near the beginning of the video. He's a professional voice actor who is currently taking commissions, and he was absolutely lovely to work with. You can find him on Twitter at r_krat. I'd also like to thank my friend Erica for voicing herself. For the record, she is into The Witcher now, but by her own admission, she's still thirsty for Yennefer. You can find her on Twitter at KaijuStan. Next, we have my many, many wonderful script editors. I really wanted to make sure I got this right, so I had a bunch of people look at it, the first of which was my friend Harper, who doesn't know anything about The Witcher, which was helpful because it let me know how this came across to someone who isn't familiar with the source material. I ended up restructuring a lot of the essay based on her feedback. You can find her on Twitter at QueerMissFrizzle. Next up is my friend Belle, who helped point out some of the stuff with Yennefer's portrayal that I missed, like the fact that she's the only disabled person in the show. You can find her on Archive of Her Own at Volumegerare, or on Tumblr at Yennets. I also have my friend Ari look at it, as well as their roommate who knows a lot more about The Witcher, and they gave it the thumbs up as well. You can find both of them on Tumblr at Akari-Hope and Bonds of Eternal Flame. Next we have Poppycock, who provided a lot of the information about Poland, including the link I put at the beginning. They've been tirelessly documenting the situation in Poland on Discord, and I wouldn't know about a lot of this stuff if not for them. Finally, there's Finn, who introduced me to the social model of disability and helped me with the section on forced sterilization and eugenics to make sure I got my points across effectively. You can find them on Twitter at FinickyArt. I know 2020 was hard on everybody. It was really hard on me. But I survived, and I learned some new skills. Getting into video editing really gave me something worthwhile to pursue, along with the chance to say things that have been sitting inside me for years. I really appreciate each and every one of you who made it this far with me, even if my audience is microscopic compared to the rest of YouTube. I didn't make this video for accolades or money or anything like that. I made it because I had something to say, and I want to thank you all for listening to me. Don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe if you want more videos like this. Happy New Year.